Run through the disclaimer, would you, Matt? Good morning.
Good morning.
Best part of the church just left us. We're going to record the sermon today, and the reason for that is I'm going to talk to you about baptism and church membership, and I thought it would be a good idea to produce something that in the future we can just say, here, look at this, and so that's why we're videotaping. This is the first time we've ever done this, and hopefully if I do a good job, we can get it out there in the future. I want to talk to you about specifically about Acts chapter 17, verse 28, where Paul quotes this line from a very famous Greek poem, which says, "In him we live and move and have our being." This is a poem called Phenomena, and it was written sometime between 315 and 340 BC. We don't know exactly when it was written. But the point is, as Paul was preaching to some Greek people, he thought it would be wise to quote from one of their poems because it was a very well-known poem, and it was something that people kind of accepted. The interesting thing is that it's a poem to Zeus. And so if we try to quote something from a Greek god, we might be criticized for it, but Paul did it. I mean, look it up. There it is. But the point is that they understood that in God, which was Zeus was the greatest god, that they lived and moved and had their being within him. And so he was not afraid to come to them on their own level and to speak to them in words that they understood and they could accept. But what he was trying to do is get them to understand that the God of Israel was this God, and that Jesus that he was preaching was available for them. So I want to talk to you about being human, because the scriptures teach us that to be fully human, we must be in proper relationship with God, because we are made in the image of God, according to the book of Genesis. And so to be fully human is to have that relationship that was intended in the beginning. Please go ahead. Now, this is a very famous verse. It's probably almost as famous as John 3:16. It comes at the end of the Gospel of Matthew, and Jesus tells the disciples to go out and to make disciples and to baptize them. Ordinarily in America, when we think about evangelism, we think about just telling people about Jesus and asking them to accept Jesus as their Savior. And yet, if you look at the scriptures carefully, you will see that evangelism has far more to do with discipleship than it does with just the initial contact where you tell somebody about Jesus. And so he told his apostles that they should go out and they should baptize people in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. This is the Trinity. People say the Trinity isn't in the Bible. Well, there it is. It's all in one verse. There's a Father, there's a Son, and there's a Holy Spirit. Quite often, maybe once a month, we recite the Apostles' Creed in church. And the Apostles' Creed, initially, the purpose of that creed was to teach people what they should know before they were baptized. And it's not that the apostles wrote the Apostles' Creed. The Apostles' Creed is the teaching of the apostles as it was understood by the early church. And it is Trinitarian. I will talk to you a little bit about the Apostles' Creed in a bit as we get into the lesson, just a little bit. Baptism means to immerse. It doesn't mean to sprinkle. It doesn't mean to pour. There are words for sprinkle. Usually the word sprinkle is used in the Bible for sprinkling blood. It's not used for baptism ever. Pouring is one way that the church has in the past just take the water, pour it over somebody's head. But that's not the word that is used either. Baptism means to immerse. It means to take from without and put within. So we could say that we use this little baptismal bowl when we take communion. We ask you to remember your baptism by putting your finger in the water and remembering. But baptism literally means to immerse. And it means to scrub too. It means to take a bath. Go ahead, please. Peter said, repent. I think repent has kind of a negative connotation in our current society, in our current culture. But it's not a mean word. It simply means to go in a new direction. It means another word which would be like this for repent would be start over, or be born again, or be regenerated, or let the light come on. It's a change in affiliation of people. And so Peter preached this, repent and be baptized in the name of Jesus for two reasons. Number one, that your sins may be forgiven and you receive the Holy Spirit. Most often when people talk about receiving Christ, they only talk about sins being forgiven. I was reading a book by Dr. Kennedy, who was a pastor of a big Presbyterian church in Florida. And as I was reading through the book, over and over again, he says, if you were to die tonight, do you know where your eternal destiny would be? His whole emphasis in this book is to awaken people to whether they have eternal life or not. Do you think that that's a question that people really care about today? If you walked up to somebody and said, do you know if you have eternal life? Would they care whether they did or not in 21st century America?
Depends on how old they are.
If they are, how old would they have to be to?
My experience is the older you get, the more you care.
Would they think you were crazy if you asked that question today? Well, what are you talking about? There's two things here. To receive forgiveness and to receive the Holy Spirit, which is the result of believing and being baptized. We should expect. The Bible talks about baptism in the Holy Spirit. The Bible talks about baptism in fire. And it talks about baptism in water. It talks about baptism into Christ. To be immersed in all of these things. Please continue there, Matthew. Now, here's an example. And they were baptized by John the Baptist in the river, confessing their sins. And even tax gatherers, collectors came in to be baptized, and they said, what should we do? These are examples. These guys are tax collectors. They are extorting extra money from the population. And whatever it is that they're supposed to collect, they're extorting extra money, and they're putting money in their pocket. And so they need to. They need to stop. And so the answer is, don't collect any more than the prescribed amount. Then the soldiers, these are Roman soldiers who are occupying Palestine. The soldiers said, what should we do? He said, don't extort money from anyone by threats or false accusation. And be satisfied with your wages. What about this last, does this last part really apply in 21st century America? Be satisfied with your wages? Nobody's satisfied with their wages. Repent. Don't live your life for money. Don't live your life for things. Change. Now these are examples. Somebody might say, well, Jesus, what should I do? Stop cheating on the time card. What should we do? Don't lie anymore. What should we do? Forgive your family member who you haven't spoken to in 43 years. You know, it would depend on each individual what should be done. See, repentance, it means a change of affiliation and a change of heart. And so these people that were there, they got these examples. So your example would probably not be the same as their example, and yet there are things that are against the Ten Commandments that maybe each one of us needs to change. We need to have a new affiliation. We have, in fact, it says, let him who steals steal no more, rather let him labor so that he might have extra to give. Salvation doesn't just mean stop stealing, it means become a giver. So here are some examples of a life of repentance. What? So it means, I already talked about this, it means submersion. Go ahead, please. Now see that little word is. Mr. Clinton taught us, God bless him, that even little words have meaning. When did he make this statement? He was president, and where was he? He was standing in front of a grand jury. He was testifying. And they were trying to get him to admit something, which I'm sure you all remember. They asked him a question, and he answered the question by saying, it depends on what your definition of is. And he was ruthlessly mocked in the press. But it does matter what your definition of is. Because if you have one definition, then it means one thing. And if you have another definition, it means another thing. Am I right? So, words matter. Now, this is going to be important to what I'm trying to say today, so try to catch this. Go ahead, please. In this discussion, it depends on what your definition of in is. In. It's a little word like is. In. What does in mean? You are in church. Are you in the church?
Depends what the definition of the is.
Okay, the definition of the definition of in. Is the church the building, or is the church the people? I mean, theologically, it's the people. It has nothing to do with the building. The buildings come and go. They burn down. People bomb them. What does it mean to be in the church? Does it mean you are a part of the congregation? Or does it mean you're sitting in a pew on Sunday morning? See, it depends on what your definition of in is. And that's what I really want to talk to you about today, that little teeny word, in. Go ahead, please. What does it mean to believe in him? And I would suggest that you probably don't have a proper understanding of the word in. Because we could stand far off and say, I believe in him, and we mean we believe that he exists. I believe in God. I believe in Jesus. And what they mean is, they're standing as an individual saying, I believe he exists, when they're saying, I believe in him. But the Bible presents a completely different definition of in than that. In him was life, and the life was the light of the people. He that believes in him, they that believe, whoever believes in him, has eternal life. Well, what does it mean to believe in him? If the definition of in means that you are in him, then this is a true statement. If you are somebody that's standing back and saying, oh yeah, I know he exists, then you're missing the point, because you have an improper biblical understanding of the word in. And baptism has to do with being in. What? We know that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding so that we may know him who is true, and we are in him who is true. In his Son, Jesus Christ. He is the true God and eternal life. So Paul is speaking to believers. He's speaking to baptized believers. And he's saying, you, your position is in him. Your position is in Christ. Well, how do you get in there? How do you get in? How do you become in the in? Please move. So if anyone is, see, it depends on what your definition of is too. If anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. Everything old has passed away. Everything has become new. It's like what I was talking about a couple of weeks ago, how we change from our old kingdom into a new kingdom. And Paul says to the church in one place, he said, test yourself and see if you're in the faith. Unless you fail the test. Think about it. Are you really in? Are you really in Christ? And how do you get in? Biblically, you get in by baptism. Am I boring you? I know it's kind of a philosophical sermon this morning, but I want you to understand theologically what baptism means. What, please? Blessed be God the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his great mercy has caused us to be born again into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. How is it possible for Christians to have new birth? Biblically speaking and theologically speaking, the new birth, the new change from the old kingdom into the new kingdom, comes because we are baptized into his birth. When Jesus was born, he was born in Bethlehem at Christmas and all the nice stuff, snow and all those things that are Christmas, right? But if we've been placed in him, then we're born in him and we're born anew. We're born with a supernatural birth, not of a birth of a father. We're born of a spiritual birth. Just as Christ was born without a natural father, he was born of a spiritual birth. And if those who believe in him, not out there somewhere, but they're actually residing inside Christ and in him, and therefore believe. Do you understand the difference in what I'm trying to say here?
Refer to believing within him, I take it?
Yes. Because we're in him. Because in him we live and we move and we have our being, Paul says. You ever hear that song? I'm going to sing you a song. You don't want to hear it? I don't know who wrote it. They used to sing it at Elam and it went something like this. In him we live and move and have our being. In him we live and move and have our being. Remember that one, Laura? I haven't sung it in years. We who are believers because we are in him. I know you probably don't think about it this way, but this is how it's presented in the scriptures. So, supernatural birth because why? Because we're in him. Go ahead, please. Do you not know that all of us who've been baptized into Christ were baptized into his death? You know, that's a mystery to people. How can God forgive me by the death of Christ? How is it possible that I receive forgiveness because Jesus died for my sins? It's because, positionally, by faith, and in actuality, spiritually, been baptized into Christ, and therefore when he died, we died. Did you ever notice that all of these main points of Christianity have to do with baptism? His death. Don't you know it? I mean, obviously the Romans didn't know it, and so he had to write this. And so we can assume that maybe some people here don't know it either. Well, if I'm dead in Christ, I guess I won't be doing any bad stuff. I mean, my father hasn't done anything bad since he died. Here's my mother. Because when you're dead, you stop doing bad stuff. And so we have the power to stop. And it says, we're baptized into his death. Oh, nails. Whip it. Go ahead, please. We've been buried with him by baptism into death, so that just as Christ was raised from the dead, by the glory of the Father, we might too walk in newness of life. How can the sinlessness of Christ cause us to walk in a new life? Because we are in him. Next one, please. God put this power to work in Christ when he raised him from the dead and seated him at his right hand in heavenly places. It says in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6, he raised us up with him and seated us with him in the heavenly places. This verse, the idea comes from Psalm 110, where the Lord says to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies a footstool for your feet. Did you ever notice that we say, I believe in God the Father, creator of heaven and earth, and Jesus Christ, his only Son, suffered under Pontius Pilate. God raised him up and gave him, you know, seated him in the heavenly places. I mean, these things are in the Apostles' Creed, all of them. Go ahead, please. If we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep in Jesus. They've fallen asleep, but they're in Jesus. Therefore, we have a church which is alive and on the earth. The church is called the church militant, the church that's doing the deeds of God upon the earth, bringing the kingdom of God to earth. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And then we have those who have fallen asleep in Jesus, and they are in the church triumphant, and they are worshiping around the throne day and night, and bowing down and saying, holy, holy, holy is Lord God Almighty, who is and who was and who is to come. So we have a baptism into the birth, the virgin birth. We have a baptism into the life. We have a baptism into the death. We have a baptism into the ascension, where we're seated with Christ in heavenly places, and we will come back with him when he returns. So these are the basic tenets of Christianity. These are the things that are in the Apostles' Creed. These are the fundamentals that the church fought over. You know, many years ago, they asked the Colgate, which it was actually, I think it was still Rochester Theological Seminary. They started teaching some weird stuff up there. And some of the people, they wrote a letter and they demanded to know what the fundamentals were that the college believed. And the college refused to answer them because they had no right to ask what they believed. And then some people said, okay, we're going to separate from you and we're going to be fundamentalists. And we're going to believe in the virgin birth, and we're going to believe in the sinless life, and we're going to believe in the literal death of Christ. We're going to believe in the resurrection. We're going to believe in the ascension. We're going to believe in the second coming. Those were the fundamental doctrines. Now, fundamentalist today means, you know, somebody that's a Republican fringe person who's trying to change the government. But the fundamentals really are the basic tenets of Christianity that are found in the Apostles' Creed and are all said to be linked to baptism. But Peter said, repent. Believe in Jesus, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. What's the purpose of the Holy Spirit? He's the third person of the Trinity and is basically ignored in large measure. In one spirit, we're all baptized into one body. Whose body is that? The body of Christ. Baptized into the... You know, Jesus has really two bodies. He has the body that was ascended into heaven, and we're in him. And he has the body on earth, which is the church. I mean, it's very clear. You are the body of Christ. The church is the body of Christ. It's a very strong doctrine in the New Testament that we're members of one another. Doesn't matter if we're Jew or Greek, slave or poor, smart or dumb. We're all baptized by one spirit into the body of Christ. Now, a lot of times evangelism goes, have you received Jesus? Well, has he received you? It goes both ways. Next slide, please. So, you're no longer strangers. You know, Ephesus was not a very Jewish place. Pretty Greek, pretty wild. Strange customs compared to the Hebrews. You're no longer strangers. You're citizens. Saints. Saint doesn't mean, you know, some great person in the past that's performed some miracle. Saint means... what you see is what you get. Transparent ones. The church, the people of the church are always called saints, not just the most holy of them that were locked up in some monastery for the main part of their life. Saints are ordinary people that are transparent, and what you see is what you get. Members of the household, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets. You know, the apostles and prophets, I always thought the apostles meant people who were sent out and people that spoke for God, maybe predicted things, prophesied things. But the apostles and the prophets, I learned after I went back to seminary, that's what they call the Bible, the New Testament, the apostles and prophets. They're built on the foundation of what the apostles and the prophets wrote in the New Testament. Jesus is the main cornerstone. In him, the whole structure is joined together and grows into a holy temple, in whom you are also built together spiritually into a dwelling place for God. The church is the body of Christ. It is not proper theology to say, okay, I just going to accept Jesus and then I'm going to heaven. It's not right. It's not wise thinking. It's not informed thinking. To be baptized into the body of Christ means we're baptized into him as he sits on the right hand of God. We're also baptized into one another with all of our warts, moles, lesions. We're part of one another. The church are the people of God, and we're immersed. We're not just sprinkled with Christians. We're immersed with other Christians. What? The Apostles' Creed. See, we have 12 apostles. I can't read the Latin, so I don't know, but I assume that they have removed Judas and added, what was the name of the apostle that they had? Matthias? Matthias, something like that. Here, this depicts 12 apostles saying 12 things in the Apostles' Creed, which was also called the symbol of the apostles, holds 12 points of doctrine. And these 12 points of doctrine were taught in the early church to those who were ready for baptism. And they had to memorize the Apostles' Creed. Because if they wouldn't take the time to memorize the Apostles' Creed, they thought, well, maybe they aren't that serious about being a Christian. And so during Lent, which means the lengthening of days, they would give them the instruction, and they would ask the people who were wanting to be baptized to learn the Apostles' Creed, and they had to be able to recite it, of course, in Latin, because that was the normal language of the time. It was the ordinary language that people spoke. Go ahead, please. Jesus said this. Let's count them together. Abide, that's one. in me as I abide in you. How many?
Two.
Just as a branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides. How many?
Three.
In the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me.
Four.
I'm the vine, you're the branches, those who abide in me. I in them bear much fruit, because apart from me you can do nothing. Whoever does not abide in me is thrown away like a branch and withers. Such branches are gathered and thrown into the fire and burned. Who said this?
It says John in the corner.
Jesus said it. John just recorded it. Abide. To be inside. To be in. Well, sometimes people say, yeah, I want to follow Jesus. And they come and they get baptized and then they don't remain in. By their own volition. I know that's a disputed theology with some, but that's how I see it. Abide means permanently. Jesus said, I will never leave you. It's not Jesus that leads people. People leave Jesus. Abide. I was talking with a professor at Colgate many years ago. And, you know, they're Baptists up there, they're American Baptists. And I said to him about baptism, I said, well, to be baptized means to be baptized into Christ. And he said, no, it doesn't. This is a PhD. I said, what do you mean it doesn't? He goes, baptism just means church membership. And I thought, this guy is a doctor in Israel. You don't understand these things? I mean, it's like what Jesus said to Nicodemus. Yeah, it means church membership. It means to be baptized into the people of God, but it also means to be baptized into the mystical body of Christ. It means both, because the body of Christ is in two places at once. It's militant, it's triumphant. Abide. Abide in. This whole I'm gonna sit out on the hill and look over the lake and commune with God. That's good, but it's not where it's at. There's nothing wrong. Everything in its proper place. Sunday morning is not the proper place for that. Sunday night's a good place for that. Saturday night's a good place. Sunrise on Monday is a good place. During deer season, that's a good place. But it's not the proper place on Sunday. Abide. One place? Now, here's where it comes together. Baptism is you in Christ. The communion is Christ in you. Those are the two symbols. And that's the difference between the two. Take this body. Take it. Eat it, all of you. This is my blood, the life of Christ, the body of Christ. Whoever eats and drinks in an unworthy manner shall be guilty of the body and blood of Christ. Paul says in Corinthians. When we eat the Eucharist, it becomes part of us. When we have a steak, it becomes part of us. When we receive the communion, it becomes part of us. When we submit to water baptism, we become part of Him. which has its heavenly and earthly dimensions. Go ahead, please. Okay. Now, I want you to understand something about this Apostles' Creed. This, we use a more modern language one when we recite it here, but this is the old version. And it's in three parts. There are three statements. I believe in God the Father, I believe in Jesus Christ, I believe in the Holy Spirit. Baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So the church taught them the Trinitarian formula early on. I believe in God the Father, Almighty. Not some weak God. Creator of the heavens and the earth. Number two. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord. Conceived by the Holy Spirit. Supernatural birth. Born of the Virgin Mary. Suffered under Pontius Pilate, crucified, and died and was buried. Don't you know you're baptized into the death of Christ? On the third day, he rose again, resurrected life. He ascended into heaven. He's seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come to judge the living and the dead. All the main points of Christianity. And they all have to do with us being in him. Next one. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Repent, you will be forgiven of your sins, and you will receive the Holy Spirit. What does the Holy Spirit do? The Holy Spirit baptizes us into the Holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. Catholic does not mean Roman Catholic. Sorry, inform the Roman Catholics of that. Catholic means everywhere, in every place, and in every time period. That's what the word Catholic means. To say Roman Catholic is a contradiction in terms, because Catholic means universal and all-inclusive. To limit it to Roman is a mistake, but okay, that's their problem. I believe in the Catholic Apostolic Church. Baptized into the church by the Holy Spirit for the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. So that is what they learned in the first and second and third century, back when the church still baptized people by immersion. Say, they've always done it the other way? No, they haven't. Look at the catacombs in Rome. It shows baptisms of adults in completely submerged in water. Is there another slide there, Matt, or no? Okay, what are your comments on this?
I was asking Mom about this last week, but the part where it says he descended into hell, which you did not cover.
Turn around and speak into the camera, please.
The part that says he descended into hell after he died. When I was reading the Bible, I didn't find that in any of the gospel, and you didn't mention it in the sermon. And it's in the church doctrine.
It is in the Bible, but I can't give you the exact verse right now.
Okay.
Ask me later, or if any of you are interested, I'd be glad to look it up and find the verse, but it is in the scriptures. Anyone else? What do you say?
Paying attention is interesting, but I don't have any questions.
Hey, if you need water baptism, you need to see me as soon as possible. And if you've already, how many of you have I baptized? Can I see your hands? I baptized you?
No, I'm sorry.
I was going to say, my memory's going. But. Did I baptize you, Laura?
I don't know if you were in, I know Jack did, but I'm not sure whether you were involved or not at that time.
Yeah, we dipped most of the people here that were here when I came. How old were you, Sarah?
I was little.
Did I baptize you, Evan?
No question. Should people got baptized
in the nasty pond? I couldn't hear
you. How many people got baptized in the nasty pond?
In the nasty pond? We're going to do baptism the day before Easter, and it will be in a nice, warm baptistry down at Zion. fellowship, they've agreed to let us do it down there Saturday before Easter.
That's where I got baptized.
You did?
Yes, you baptized me.
I can't remember everybody I baptized. Did I baptize you, Neil?
Yeah, I was 30 years old. 2000. Right after I was married.
So it took that.
Yeah, you got a little dirty in there, but.
It's called a baptism of repentance, which means that, you know, it's not a once and for all deal. You have to repent, you have to turn around when you get going the wrong way. As long as you're going generally in the right direction, that's a good thing.
A little zigzag. Sorry.
I didn't hear you.
A little bit of a zigzag, okay.
A zig and a zag. Yeah. And, yes, sir?
You said the Saturday before Easter?
Yep. You're already baptized, though, right?
Correct. I'm thinking of my spouse.
Yes. And we'd like, in the past, I have baptized people without church membership. I'm not doing that anymore because I don't think it's scriptural. I've learned some things myself, and so we would expect. I mean, there are a couple of things that you have to assent to, which are basically the doctrines that are in the Apostles' Creed. You have to believe that, and then you also have to agree to follow the church covenant, which is like, be a good person, don't cause a lot of trouble, give us money, show up, that kind of stuff. I mean, just put it in, you know, regular language. Then the other thing is, there's a set, on the application it says, I agree to be governed by the constitution of the, and bylaws of Cheshire Community Church. And in that constitution it says, if you mess up, you could get thrown out. If you mess up really bad and you're unwilling to change that, we will be coming to see you. And a couple of people have messed up in the past and they've said to us, well, you never told us that. Well, I'm telling you now. And if you refuse, like if you say to me, I'm going to just continue to rob stores, I don't care what you say, you're not a suitable member. And so, you know, whatever it is on that kind of level, we will expect you to live as a Christian following your baptism. Because baptism has to do with being clean and making a change and being a godly person. May God bless you. Have a great day.
Thank you.